On today's show,
the Clippers are off to their worst start since Chris Paul joined them. What or whom's to blame?
Brent Barry stops by to tell us if the Warriors owe it to the fans to go all out for 72 wins.
And we've got brain farts left and right in a new edition of Weekend Whoopsies.
It's Monday, November 23rd. The starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast or catching us on NBA TV and or YouTube, we're happy to have you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, Tass Mellis.
Hello. It's me.
To his right, the international man of mystery, Lee Ellis.
Friends.
Lee. And finally, last but not least, over at the podium, checking the internet, Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Heyo!
Heyo!
Guys, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag the starters, and we're gonna start things off by giving a quick shout out to Lee Ellis, because over at GQ.com, there's a new article up titled, Five Reasons Why Men Can and Should Do Bar Class. If you've been watching the show for, I don't know, about a year and a half,
yep.
He is a devoted practitioner of Bar 3, a combination of ballet, yoga, and Pilates. Some of the reasons include it's not as ballet-y as you think, and you probably aren't working out your legs enough, so Lee.
Certainly your hamstrings.
Yeah, you can, I love getting a nice look at your hamstrings.
Did you have a secret camera in there or what?
Lee scooped us on this one, so if you're watching at home, tell us what's the next big trend that Lee Ellis will start. Tweet at us, use hashtag the starters, and we'll check some of your answers a bit later.
All right, we got a fun lined up for you tonight. Brent Barry will join us. He's back in the Bone Zone to talk about the Warriors and their perfect start. And we'll have a new batch of Weekend Whoopsies. But we're starting with a little fill in the blank. We usually like to do it here on Monday. We ask you to play along at home as well. Jump on Twitter, hashtag the starters. Let's start with the Clippers. They had a bad weekend. You know, it started on Thursday when they blew the lead to the Warriors, but less than 24 hours later, they got killed by the Blazers, 102-91. Portland had entered that contest on a 7-game losing streak. Then on Sunday, LA was blown off their own floor by the Raptors, trailing by 29 at halftime. They eventually made it look semi-respectable. They lost by 11, but the Clippers have lost 3 in a row, 7 of their last 9. They're now 6-7 on the year. Fill in the blank. The Clippers are falling apart because what?
Because of the Warriors. The Warriors are doing
the
Warriors are doing everything this year. They're winning their own games and they're sending other teams into tailspins. Both times the Warriors have played the Clippers, they really sent them down the wrong path. First time, the Clippers were 4-0 going into that game against Golden State. They're 2-7 since. And then Thursday, you mentioned it, the comeback. They're questioning themselves after this. I feel like they don't know themselves after this game. They're really thinking, can we beat this team? Can we be a number one seed? And I think they're looking around the locker room and they're just kind of hanging their heads. I blame it on the Warriors. I think the Clippers just don't know who they are because Golden State beats them up.
Wow.
It really is. I think that's what it is.
Hangovers usually come after wins, but they've got it after the loss. And I think you're right. I think that loss to the Warriors was so demoralizing, it did actually affect their other two games, especially against the Raptors. They looked beaten, they looked exhausted, and they looked like they were out of ideas. Doc Rivers on the side, you could see him a few times. He just couldn't believe the way his team was playing because if you look, they've got two All-Stars, obviously, in Blake and Chris Paul. And those guys look like they're carrying so much weight on their shoulders right now, and they're not getting the support, especially from the bench players who they brought in this year to help bolster that second unit. And I think right now, it's a fair point, Tass. I think the Clippers are just beaten up, and they look at the Warriors and think, we are nowhere near competing with them right now.
Reports after the latest loss, Josh Smith in the locker room, arguing with an assistant coach, yet to be named, a lot of yelling going on, a lot of frustration. I think it's pretty obvious this team is frustrated with this slow start. But I will say this, I think we're going a little overboard here. They didn't start any of the last couple years on fire by any means. 8-5 actually over the last couple years. So take away the two games against the Warriors. Now they're 6-5 and it's not that different than an 8-5 start. This is when they usually get it going, but I think there are problems with this team, be it the small forward position and the bench, which we thought was way better heading into this year, and they have not performed, Tass. I know you thought they were much improved, so did I. And they haven't. They haven't been.
Yeah, to me, I don't think you can point to one thing when, you know, you lose or you're down by 29 to the Toronto Raptors. To me, it's not the bench. It's the starting unit. It's everybody. And it's Lance Armstrong. Lance Armstrong has looked very bad for this team. I mean, his bracelets aren't on the right way. He just doesn't look right. Lance Stephenson has not worked out. The fact that Doc Rivers is already pulling him because he hasn't been mentally ready or in there. To me, it's just the locker room wide, and I'm okay with them yelling at each other. I'm great with that. That's entirely fine. It means they care, because on the floor on Sunday against the Raps, they definitely didn't care.
Okay, bad weekend for the Clippers. Good weekend for the Pelicans. We haven't been able to say that in a little while. They went and took care of the Spurs on Friday night. Anthony Davis returning from a sore shoulder to help them get that 104-90 win, just their second victory of the season. They followed it up on Sunday with AD playing even better. Pelicans hold on to beat the Suns. That's two wins in a row. They're now 3-11, which, yes, sounds awful still, but better than 1-11 or 1-12 or 1-13. So on a scale of 1 to 10, I'm going to give you the scale here. The Pelicans' playoff chances are what?
They're 8. I'm believing in this team. I believe in the energy in this team.
10 being high, not 1. Okay.
I just believe that this team is feeling like it can make the playoffs. Injuries heal, and I think Anthony Davis really feels that and recognizes that. And let's not underestimate one of the best players in the league feeling good. I think he understands that that 3-11 start was kind of warranted. Yeah, it's a terrible record, but they're only expected to go 4-10 according to ESPN's rankings because of those injuries. Again, a really, really, really depleted team. The toughest schedule in the league. So it's sort of expected. And I think everyone obviously coming in are coming back is just going to help them.
You agree with
I think this is a very, very good team. Tyreke Evans, I think, is the key. He might be back Wednesday. Then they're almost healthy. And again, you got your best player leading. I'm comfortable saying that.
8's a little optimistic for me. I'm going to go about a 7 because Norris Cole's also.
That's optimistic.
Yeah, it's still optimistic because
very optimistic. One different man.
but they're only 3.5 games back of the Clippers for 8th right now. So they're not too far off even being in that playoff race. They've got a very tough schedule coming up. They've got the Suns, Clippers, and Jazz this week, all on the road. So that could really be one of those sort of two-game performances where you've got to, if you lose those games, you drop further behind. But if they win all those, then they're back in the mix.
They're definitely helped by the Clippers not playing that great. Your team's like the Grizzlies in the mix there. I know they've turned it around a little bit. You know, the Rockets, there are these teams that we just sort of expected, they'll be, 9-4 at this point, no problem. And there are all these teams struggling, so that helps the Pelicans' chances.
There are openings, baby.
All right, I love this next one. Kristaps Porzingis. Huge weekend for him. Quite a weekend for 3-6 Latvia, as they're calling him, or World Star, whatever you want to call him. Saturday night.
Porzingis.
He puts together one of the most complete performances of the season for him. He leads the Knicks to a win, or helps lead them to the win over the Rockets. He became the first rookie to post at least 24 points, 14 boards, and 7 blocks in a game since Tim Duncan did it as a rookie in 98. The youngest to post that line since Shaquille O'Neal. So we're throwing out names like Duncan and Shaq, so a heck of a game from Porzingis. So we'll start with you, Lee. Fill in the blank. Knicks fans that booed Porzingis on draft day should have to what?
Buy a jersey. Buy a Porzingis jersey, yeah. I mean, they sold out at the NBA store, so they might have to wait a week or two.
You can't get one.
Yeah, but I think Phil Jackson, it's fair to say right now, he got it right at number 4. There was a lot of skeptics, myself included, but Porzingis has shown he's a lot further advanced as an NBA player at this stage of his career than a lot of people would have expected,
Definitely. Particularly
on the defensive end.
That's what I was going to say. 24 and 14, that's great. Yeah. 7 blocks really jumps out
because we knew he could shoot coming in. That was what he was sort of made out to be, a good shooter. And it's not he's just settling for 3-point. He's not actually shooting that well from 3. He's got that nice little drop step where he can get himself into a position to get a good shot off. He's got those long arms. It's kind of like Kevin Durant. Kind of makes it hard to block, so he's getting good looks. But then at the defensive end especially, he is really challenging guys without fouling.
He had a couple blocks in that game against the Rockets over the weekend where I was like, whoa, that's Roy Hibbert.
Yeah,
where he just throws his arms up because he's a giant guy, and guys sort of are almost like shooting it into his arms because his reach is that
long. Hibbert style.
Yeah, he can read the defense really well, which is a skill at this age, I think, for a young guy, especially a European.
We knew that he could shoot, obviously, but we didn't know that he could get his own shot. There's a lot of times where the Knicks are trying to get Melo the ball, and they kind of go to Porzingis for a bailout because they can't get him the ball. He could step back and get his own shot if he's being covered, no problem. And let's remember, he's doing this only after being in America for a couple months. He's only been on this side of the water for a couple months. That is impressive for a young kid to do that. You know, when you mentioned Duncan and Shaq, at least they came up, grew up here. This is pretty big.
It's crazy.
I don't want to overreact just because he's in New York, but let's overreact.
People are. Don't worry. All right, final one here. Let's try and get this in. We'll start with you, Trey. But during Friday night's game against the Clippers, the Blazers were graced by the presence of a wallaby named Momo. That's Portia there, the owner of Momo. Now, she suffers from anxiety attacks and adopted Momo 3 months ago to serve as sort of a therapy animal. That's why she was allowed to have Momo in there. The Blazers went on to win that night, snapped a 7-game losing streak, as I already said, so maybe Momo's some good luck. But I'll ask you, Trey, like I said, a wallaby at a game is the cutest thing to happen in the NBA since what?
Well, for me, the cutest thing to happen to the NBA ever is my baby being kidnapped by Benny the Bull. Maybe another choice, though, could be when Ricky Rubio finally came to the States looking very cute. But if we're sticking animal-themed, I think I'm going to go with when Polo, the therapy bulldog, showed up at a Knicks game and somehow got courtside seats. You know how rich of a dog you have to be to sit courtside at a Knicks game? This is incredible. Look at this guy. Everybody just wants a few pets with. I think this is a French bulldog. I don't really know how to keep them separate, but I don't know. Anytime there's an animal at a game, people are loving it.
All right, that's a good question for everyone out there. Tweet at us, @starters, #TheStarters. A wallaby at a game is the cutest thing to happen in the NBA since what? Is the answer Ricky Rubio? Is it as simple as that? I don't know. You guys let us know. We got to take a break. When we come back, Bones is back in the Bone Zone.
Oh, he's cute.
Yeah.
We'll talk to him about the Warriors' perfect 15-0 start. Oh, he's yelling at us.
Just face it, you're cute.
Welcome back to Full House. Brent Barry here in the Bone
acoustic,
Zone.
Acoustic, by the way.
Two-time NBA champ. Bones, thanks for joining us.
Good to see you guys.
We're going to get to your goodies that you have with you.
Yeah, let's get to those after. Can I make one quick mention? Mm. How about Riley Curry?
Riley Curry, oh.
Cutest thing to happen to the NBA.
That's pretty cute. Good.
I'm submitting that.
Yeah, get on your, get your phone out. Tweet
and
it.
Maybe the Clippers could use one of those animals right now to settle themselves.
Ouch. Yeah. I love it. All right, Bones got a lot to say here, but before we get to that, we asked earlier what other trends Lee might start, and the people have spoken, Trey.
Yeah, some good answers. CA9 skill says center's making free throws. You know Lee likes to coach them up.
Yeah, I'd love to work on that.
Ben K says the next trend Lee else will start is saying friends instead of hello or what's up. It's a new form of greetings. I don't see that catching on, but you never know. And my favorite, Nathan Andrews says, Lee Ellis will start the baggy clothes trend. We going back to the future.
Yeah.
It's Somebody's got to bring boot cuts back.
It's a cycle. Laugh at me now, but a couple of years
Okay, we will.
Bones, what do you got here?
I had the chance to do the Minnesota Timberwolves against the Warriors a couple weeks ago, and their PR staff did a great job of providing some gifts, and I'm always thinking of you guys. So I've got, for you running around, we've got the Timberwolves cold weather gloves.
Oh, these are right.
For your runs, that would work.
Thank you, Timberwolves.
Tass, I've got you the Timberwolves ice scraper. I don't know if in Atlanta you're going to need that, but
no.
Occasionally here. Lee, I've got the skull cap.
Thank you. On, Lee.
Yeah, I do need one of these.
Scully.
It's been a little fresh here.
I'll get up for this one. I'm going to bring it over to Trey. Trey, I've got the lip balm for you.
Sweet.
With the beard and all, I figured.
Yeah, a real winter theme from the Wolves. I like
that. And then lastly, really cool. We'll do this for the set. I guess we'll...
Oh, God.
That's the
my God.
Andrew Wiggins bobblehead.
Oh, you guys missed the lip chap shot.
Oh, sorry. Didn't see
Andrew, this is the Andrew Wiggins bobblehead.
I wish I missed out on
this. We don't have enough bobbleheads here, but we appreciate
throw
it.
Throw that one in.
Thank you.
All right, we got a couple things we want to talk to you about, because it's been a while. You said you called the Warriors game against the Wolves.
Then the Bucks Cavs last
that's
week.
That's right.
Which was
busy man.
You obviously saw the Warriors win, because they haven't lost yet.
Yes. We all have seen them win every time.
Yeah, 15-0. They over the weekend took care of Chicago, Denver. They've tied the hottest start to the season in NBA history. A lot of people are talking about this small ball lineup that we've seen Luke Walton go with a little bit more frequently than they did last regular season. We saw it in the playoffs for sure, but I'm talking the Splash Brothers and Stephen Clay, Iguodala, Harrison Barnes, and Draymond Green.
I'm calling this the ice lineup, by the way. I'm trying to promote ice lineup. In case of emergency, ice lineup. Wow. Bring these guys out, put the game on ice. They're incredible. You see the plus minus right now. They're off the charts. I think their offensive rating is 157 right now, which is higher than Vince Cellini's IQ, which I didn't think that could ever be possible.
Oh, he's a smart man, is he? Oh, didn't know that.
But they're, you know, to say how it is that you stop this lineup, one of the ways that you saw a team try to do it was with the Cavs last year, just basically putting LeBron James in and trying to disrupt the rhythm of the Golden State Warriors offensively by playing super slow, super physical, deep into the shot clock, and see if you can mess with their psyche that way. I don't think that that necessarily is going to work. But you're going to have to pick and choose who's going to beat you. I mean, right. That's really what teams are trying to do. And to that end, you know, Draymond Green and Harrison Barnes would be the guys that you challenge to make shots. Well, guess what?
They are.
They're actually making shots. So, you know, to say how you do this, I really don't know. Obviously, 15 teams have not figured it out. But to me, the best thing that coaches can do in the NBA is be the best version of yourself.
Right.
Do not try to be Golden State. Mm. You don't have Steph Curry. You don't have their shooting abilities. You don't have their defensive abilities to switch. Be the best versions of yourselves. And so when teams get to that point, they'll have opportunities to be in range of these guys. But what they've done so far has been awesome.
This next one, it's sort of a tough question, but I'm interested to hear your take on it. We got into a huge debate in the office about this earlier today. It's about the idea of whether or not the Warriors owe it to NBA fans in general to chase these sort of records, be it the start to the season, which it looks like they're going to do. I'm sorry, Lakers fans. They're probably going to go 16-0. But more importantly, or less importantly to some, in some people's minds, chase the Bulls 72-10 record. What's your opinion on the idea of they almost owe it to the game and to fans to have a realistic go at it?
Well, I mean, I don't know how you guys voted. I actually would have liked to have heard your commentary on that and which way you guys went, because I would just tell you from a player's perspective that I've always felt like your job is to play as hard as you can for as long as you can and to give your chance a team to win every night. To me, that's the language right now that the Warriors have been speaking publicly to the media. I've enjoyed that honesty with them. Mm-hmm. I've enjoyed Luke Walton talking about, look, if we get better every game and we're playing our best by playoffs and 72 wins or 73 wins is a byproduct of the process that we're going through, then we're okay with that. But I don't think you ever put a number on the season. Mm. But as a player, I will just tell you, as a player, your job is that you want to come in and play and maximize your potential and play for the guy next to you. To me, that's how Golden State has approached this, and it's refreshing to see that and to hear that kind of dialogue from that team so far.
Right. I think they owe it to their fans to win a championship, and that means likely playing the bench a little bit more so they're going in the postseason and to be as healthy as possible, so not to play every single minute of a fourth quarter, even if that means that you could win it and win that particular game.
Growing up in the Bay Area and knowing that it's been 40 years since the Warriors won a championship and winning it last year, they're not asking much more than that.
Right. You know,
they're pretty good right now marinating in what happened last year.
Again, I think this will get very interesting come March or April if the record is in play.
Yeah,
and then it's like, do you rest guys while you head into the playoffs?
Well, we'll just wait when they get to 22 and we're talking about the Lakers 33. Yeah. That'll be fun.
That's a good point. All right,
good
Bones,
to see you
thanks
guys.
Thanks for the gift, man.
Me too.
We really appreciate it. We'll come right back. The new batch of Weekend Whoopsies. You're watching The Starters. Back of The Starters. There she is. Wait, is it a he or she, Momo? I'm not sure. But that is the Blazers therapy wallaby. And we asked you, what's the cutest thing to happen to the NBA? A wallaby at a game is the cutest thing to happen to the NBA since what? We asked you to fill in the blank. Excuse me, Trey.
Yeah, as Bone suggested, there was quite a few Riley Currys, but we got some other answers as well. JJ Duma says, since Olynyk doing the Dirk on Dirk. Pretty cute moment, no
cute.
Doubt. Scooby Spike throws it back. Cutest thing since Sweet Mo Cheeks assisted the young girl who forgot the national anthem.
Great moment.
Classic moment.
Great
YouTube
moment.
It if you somehow haven't seen it. And David Stroop Jr. says, the Charles Barkley Dick Pavetta race during the 2007 NBA All-Star Game, hashtag brotherly love, hashtag still strange. That is strange. An active NBA referee raced a guy from TV.
And then they kissed.
And then they kissed.
Yeah, that was a great moment.
Great race.
All right, keep it coming, guys. Hashtag the stars. All right, also a staple here on Monday, we look back at the NBA weekend and hit you with the weekend whoopsies. We got a whole bunch here.
Melo might have some sensitive ears. Check the baseline here. Referee blows the whistle. Melo drops the ball because he can't stand the sound.
Too loud.
And this isn't the first time that this happened. Last season, same thing happened to Carmelo Anthony. Ken Maurer, oh no, just turns away, ball goes flying. No, not doing it, Ken. He's counting. Give me the ball.
He got a tech for that, didn't he? All right, this weekend, Marcus Smart had a brain fart. Mm. Ball's
not
tipped
very smart.
While he's inbounding it. and he just catches it. You're standing out of bounds, Marcus.
I like the way he just tried to hand it off to the referee. Like, let's do that again.
Staying with the Celtics, Isaiah Thomas tries to be smart. It doesn't work out. Obviously, not allowed. Can't leave the circle before it's tipped, Isaiah. Come on now.
You knew too.
That's a cute moment, though. Cute moment.
Friday night, Rockets Grizzlies. Dwight Howard, doink. Doesn't see the pass coming.
Well, he hasn't seen a whole lot coming.
But here's the thing. He got the hockey assist here. The Grizzlies go down and hit the three there. Get your head up.
If you could encapsulate the Rockets' play in one season and one play, I mean, Marc Gasol. The beautiful game is basketball to me, but he can also play the other beautiful game.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Oh, come on, Mike Conley, use your head.
Look at this. Super slow-mo of Marc Gasol working it.
He sort of loses it.
He does. Let's cut away before he loses it. Let's cut back to Marc Gasol doing it last year using the head. Oh, this is actually very impressive.
The header. Yeah.
Saturday, LeBron is a little frustrated for some reason, despite being up 26 midway through the third. So he subs himself out of the game without a buzzer, leading to a technical foul on his team. Because look, there's only four guys out there. You gotta wait there, LeBron. He apologized for the situation afterwards, saying, "I blew a gasket." You know what that means? I apologize to my teammates for it. Blew a gasket.
You should apologize for those shorts, I think.
Oh, come on.
You're keeping one to class.
Yeah, apologize for your shirt, Lee, and your pants.
And your everything.
Yeah.
Chase Budinger should have definitely apologized for this pass.
Whoa.
I saw this written down. Yeah, great pass.
Look, Johnny O'Brien's right there.
Starts the fast break.
Saturday, back to the Hawks and Knicks. J.R. Smith, he just gets buckets. Doesn't matter what team it's for, man. His own net, doesn't matter. Look, it tips it in by accident. Going for the rebound.
That's a great tipping.
We're going to finish it off with a beauty here. Mirza Teletovic, you can't make this stuff up. Goes off the head of Anthony Davis.
Step back.
And hits a three. Check this angle. It's literally off AD's unibrow. Back to Mirza. For the three.
AD on one mixtape tour, I think.
Yeah.
AD nearly blocks it. He still almost gets there.
That's cold, Mirza.
There it is. Weekend whoopsies. Always kind to us. All right, gotta take a break. When we come back, Lily's very solid play of the night. And lots more. You're watching The Starters. Back with The Starters, time for Lili's very solid play of the night, Lee.
We're going to Los Angeles, but it's another one from the Raptors, and it's Luis Scola and Kyle Lowry hooking up, and then Bismack just dropping it in there. Could have been a layup there from Bismack, but he threw it down. He's wide open. That's beautiful. That's what I call a very solid play.
Awesome.
Very solid indeed, but I'm kind of surprised you didn't pick another play from this very same game. Also in Los Angeles, DeAndre Jordan knows he's winning a jump ball, sends Wesley Johnson on a fly pattern, hits him with the deep tip. No dribbles, no passes on this fast break, just a dunk and probably a travel, and that's what I call a very solid play.
Tonight's pick and play, we'll throw that up on Facebook, so hit us up over there, back tomorrow night at 7 p.m.
Thanks for joining us, folks, and remember, if you're gonna wear a lip chap, wear a lot, so it looks glossy.
Cake it on.
People.